the case number IT-9834, the prosecutor versus Mladen Naletlic and Vinko Martinovic.
Thank you, Madam Registrar. Mr. Naletlic and Mr. Martinovic, can you clearly hear and understand the translation?
Yes, Your Honor. Yes, thank you, Your Honor.
I would now ask for the appearances of the parties. First, of the defense.
Good afternoon, Your Honor. Matt Hennessy and Chris Meek from Mladen Naletlic.
Good afternoon, Your Honors. Joe Gopar and Kurt Kearns on behalf of Mr. Martinovic.
I thank you. Now for the prosecution.
Good afternoon, Your Honor. Good afternoon to my learned colleagues, Norman Farrell, Mr. Peter Kramer, Ms. Marius Lekind, Mr. Steppenworth, Mr. Xavier Tracol, and our case manager, Lourdes Galizia, for the prosecution. Thank you.
Thank you. As the registrar announced, the case on our agenda is prosecutor versus Mladen Naletlic and Vinko Martinovic. In accordance with the scheduling order issued on 18 April 2006, today the appeals chamber will deliver its judgment. Following the practice of the International Tribunal, I will not read out the text of the judgment except for the disposition. Instead, I will summarize the issues on this appeal and the findings of the appeal chamber. I emphasize that the summary is not part of the written judgment, which is the only authoritative account of the appeal chamber's rulings and reasons. Copies of the written judgment will be made available to the parties at the conclusion of the hearing. The events giving rise to this appeal took place between April 93 and January 94 during the conflict between the Croatian Defense Council, HVO, and the Army of Bosnia and Herzegovina, ABIH, in Mostar and its surrounding municipalities in southwestern Bosnia and Herzegovina. In particular, this appeal deals with crimes related to the HVO attack on the villages of Sovici and Doljani that began on 17 April 93, the HVO attack on Mostar that began on 9 May 93, and the HVO attack on the village of Rashtani beginning on 22nd September 93. Mr. Naletlic founded a military group called the Convicts Battalion, or the KB, which after the conflict in Mostar against the Serb-Montenegrin forces in 92 became a professional unit for special combat under the direct command of the HVO main staff. Attached to the KB were several anti-terrorist groups units called ATGs. On 31st of March 2003, the trial chamber found Mr. Naletlic guilty under 8 counts for the crimes of persecutions as a crimes against humanity, unlawful labor as a violation of the laws or customs of war, torture as a crime against humanity, torture as a grave breach of the Geneva Conventions of 1949, willfully causing great suffering or serious injury to body or health as a grave breach of the Geneva Conventions of 1949, unlawful transfer of a civilian as a grave breach of the Geneva Convention of 1949, wanton destruction not justified by military necessity as a violation of the laws or customs of war, and plunder of public or private property as a violation of the laws or customs of war. Mr. Naletlic was found to be individually responsible pursuant to Article 7.1 of the Statute of the International Tribunal for Certain Crimes, and responsible as a superior under Article 7.3 of the Statute for other crimes. The trial chamber imposed on Mr. Naletlic a single sentence of 20 years of imprisonment. Mr. Martinovic joined in 1992 the Croatian Defense Forces and became a commander. At least from mid-May 93, he was the commander of a group of soldiers who held positions at a confrontation line in Mostar. He was the commander of the Vinkoshrobo ATG, which was part of the KB. The trial chamber found Mr. Martinovich guilty under 9 counts for the crimes of persecutions as a crimes against humanity, inhuman acts as a crimes against humanity, inhuman treatment as a grave breach of the Geneva Convention of 1949, unlawful labor as a violation of the laws or customs of war, willfully causing great suffering or serious injury to body or health as a grave breach of the Geneva Conventions of 49, murder as a crimes against humanity, willful killing as a grave breach of the Geneva Conventions of 1949, unlawful transfer of a civilian as a grave breach of the Geneva Conventions of 49, and plunder of public or private property as a violation of the laws or customs of war. Mr. Martinovich was found to be directly responsible under Article 7.1 of the statute for crimes, as well as responsible as a superior under 7.3, Article 7.3 of the statute, for other crimes. The trial chamber imposed on Mr. Martinovich a single sentence of 18 years of imprisonment. I will now address the grounds of appeal in turn, starting with Mr. Naletilich's and Mr. Martinovich's grounds concerning due process of law, and their grounds relating to the international character of the armed conflict, followed by two of the prosecution's grounds relating to persecutions and deportation. I will then address Mr. Naletilich's and Mr. Martinovich's grounds challenging various factual findings in the trial judgment and the prosecution's appeal together with Mr. Martinovich's appeal on cumulative convictions. Lastly, I will address Mr. Naletilich's and Mr. Martinovich's grounds of appeal on sentencing, which will be followed by a reading of the disposition of the judgment. Now, turning to Mr. Naletilich's and Mr. Martinovich's grounds relating to due process of law. Mr. Naletilich alleges under his 12th and 21st grounds of appeal, and Mr. Martinovich under his second ground of appeal, that the indictment was too vague and that it did not sufficiently plead the number of incidents for which they were found responsible. The appeal chamber recalls that the question of whether an indictment is pleaded with sufficient particularity is dependent upon whether it sets out the material facts of the prosecution case with enough detail to inform an accused clearly of the charges against him or her, so that the accused may prepare a proper defense. In some instances, however, a conviction may be entered under a defective indictment where it is deemed to have been cured because the accused has received timely, clear, and consistent information from the prosecution detailing the factual basis underpinning the charge against him or her, such that the accused was in a reasonable position to understand the charges brought. Where the failure to give sufficient notice of the legal and factual reasons for the charges against the accused has violated the right to a fair trial, no conviction may result. While the appeal chamber finds that the indictment failed to plead material facts in relation to the charges for most of the incidents challenged by Mr. Naletilich and Mr. Martinovich, it has found that the prosecution provided timely, clear, and consistent information that cured these defects in the indictment, with the exception of the following three incidents. First, the turning of a private property into the headquarters of Mr. Martinovich's unit around 7 July 93. Second, the incident of beating in July or August 93 involving several prisoners in the area under Mr. Martinovich's command. And finally, the incidents of beating involving a prisoner called Zotza. Thus, the trial chamber erred in finding Mr. Martinovich responsible for these three incidents. The appeal chamber dismisses in its entirety Mr. Naletsky's 12th grand of appeal and his 21st grand of appeal insofar as it relates to the alleged vagueness of the indictment. It allows Mr. Martinovich's second grand of appeal in part. Next, as part of his first grand of appeal, Mr. Martinovich submits that the trial chamber erred in law in finding that alternative charges could be brought against him. The appeal chamber holds that while alternative charging on the basis of the same conduct is generally permissible, it depends on the circumstances of the case. In this case, the trial chamber was correct in finding that alternative charging was permissible. The appeal chamber recalls that it has previously held that cumulative charging on the basis of the same acts is generally allowed on the basis that prior to the presentation of all of the evidence, it is not possible to determine to a certainty which of the charges brought against an accused will be proven. The same reasoning allows for alternative charging. As with cumulative charging, the trial chamber is better poised after the party's presentation of the evidence to evaluate which of the charges may be retained based upon the sufficiency of the evidence. The appeal chamber, therefore, dismisses Martinovich's sub-ground of appeal in its entirety. Turning now to Mr. Naletsky and Mr. Martinovich's ground of appeal concerning the international character of the armed conflict. The trial chamber found both Mr. Naletsky and Mr. Martinovich guilty on several counts of grave breaches of the Geneva Convention of 1949 pursuant to Article 2 of the Statute. On appeal, Mr. Naletsky, under his 37th ground of appeal, and Mr. Martinovich, under his first ground of appeal, submit that the trial chamber erred in law by holding that an international armed conflict existed during the period and in the area relevant to the indictment, and consequently by finding them guilty of grave breaches of the Geneva Conventions of 1949. They submit that the evidence presented to the trial chamber was unreliable, and in addition, that they cannot be held responsible for the character of the armed conflict. The appeals chamber finds that Mr. Naletsky and Mr. Martinovich's claim concerning the unreliability of the evidence do not meet the formal requirements for raising an appeal, and as such, they are dismissed. Next, the appeal chamber notes that Mr. Naletsky and Mr. Martinovich were not found responsible for the fact that the conflict was international, but rather for the crimes committed in the context of an international armed conflict. However, the appeal chamber finds that a related issue, which both Mr. Naletsky and Mr. Martinovich assert by implication, requires further consideration, namely, whether the trial chamber erred in law by failing to require the prosecution to prove, as an element of crimes under Article 2 of the Statute, that they were aware of the international character of the armed conflict. The appeal chamber recalls that Article 2 of the Statute gives the International Tribunal the power to prosecute persons committing or ordering to be committed grave breaches of the Geneva Conventions of 1949, namely certain acts against persons whose property protected under the provisions of the relevant Geneva Convention. The language of the Geneva Conventions makes clear that the grave breaches regime applies only in international armed conflicts. In Tadic, the appeals chamber concluded that the international armed conflict element had been incorporated into Article 2 of the statute such that it only applies to offenses committed within the context of international armed conflicts. The appeal chamber holds that the existence and international character of an armed conflict are both jurisdictional prerequisites, as established in Tadic, and substantive elements of crimes pursuant to Article 2 of the statute. In Kodic and Cherkes, the appeal chamber stated that although the accused need not make a correct legal evaluation as to the international character of the armed conflict, he must be aware of the factual circumstances, that is, that a foreign state was involved in the armed conflict in order to be held responsible for an Article 2 crime. This is because the principle of individual guilt requires that an accused can only be convicted for a crime if his mens rea comprises the actus reus of the crime. To convict him without proving that he knew of the facts that were necessary to make his conduct a crime is to deny him his entitlement to the presumption of innocence. Thus, the prosecution's obligation to prove intent for a crime charged under Article 2 also encompasses establishing the accused knowledge of the factual circumstances pertinent to the internationality of an armed conflict. As a result, the appeal chamber finds that the trial chamber erred in failing to explicitly find that the prosecutor showed that Mr. Naletelic and Mr. Martinovic were aware of the facts making the armed conflict international. However, this error did not affect the trial judgment. Based on the entirety of the findings contained in the trial judgment, a reasonable trier of fact could only have found that Mr. Naletelic and Mr. Martinovic were aware of the requisite factual circumstances. I now turn to the prosecution's grounds of appeal relating to persecutions and to deportation. As its first ground of appeal, the prosecution contends that the trial chamber adopted an incorrect approach in law and in fact to the evaluation of the evidence in holding that certain crimes committed by Martinovic did not constitute underlying acts of persecutions due to insufficient evidence that they were committed on racial, political, or religious grounds. The prosecution contends that the trial chamber did not consider whether the discriminatory grounds could be inferred from the context of the incidents or the evidence as a whole. The appeal chamber recalls that it is well established that discriminatory intent may be inferred from the context of an attack on the civilian population, where it is substantiated by the circumstances surrounding the acts allegedly underlying the crime of persecutions. However, the appeal chamber finds that the prosecution has failed to show that the circumstances surrounding the incidents it raises substantiate its claim that the acts in question were carried out with discriminatory intent. The appeal chamber therefore dismisses the prosecution's first ground of appeal in its entirety. At its third ground of appeal, the prosecution contends that the trial chamber erred in law in holding that deportation requires the transfer of persons across state borders in order to distinguish it from forcible transfer. The appeal chamber notes that there is no occasion in this case to define the elements of deportation as a crime against humanity under Article 5D of the statute, as the indictment included no charges under that article. The appeal chamber, therefore, need not address the trial chamber's comments in paragraph 870 of its judgment to the effect that the International Tribunal's jurisprudence defines deportation as transfer across a state border. The appeal chamber also sees no need to consider the issue as a matter of general significance to the International Tribunal's jurisprudence, as the issue has been settled in the Stakish appeal judgment. Furthermore, The question whether deportation encompasses a border element is irrelevant for the purposes of liability under Article 5H, because acts of forcible displacement are equally punishable as underlying acts of persecutions, whether or not a border is crossed. It is not necessary for the purposes of a persecution's conviction to distinguish between the underlying acts of deportation and forcible transfer. The criminal responsibility of the accused is sufficiently captured by the general concept of forcible displacement. To the extent the trial chamber suggested otherwise, it erred in law, but this error did not affect the judgment, as both Mr. Naletelic and Mr. Martinovic were in any event convicted for persecutions through the underlying act of forcible transfer. For these reasons, Judge Schomburg dissenting, the prosecution's third ground of appeal is dismissed.